Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where everything we talk about is related to changing the world of work so that more organizations can be more effective and less dysfunctional, and employees can be more fulfilled and less miserable. I'm your host, Pat Lencioni, joined by Cody Thompson, my trusty co-host. How are you doing today, Cody?
Trusty. Cheery.
Cheery.
I don't know.
And
you pick a word this time. Yeah, I've run out. I'm going to go back to great.
Let's go with great.
Yeah.
We've got two people on mic and a host of people in the studio audience here today. Tracy Noble, our trusty manager, producer, adult supervision. How are you doing today, Tracy?
I'm great.
He's really throwing the word trusty around.
I am. Jeez.
And our non-trusty friend.
Exactly.
How you doing, Bo?
I'm great too.
Bo here's here. He's usually in Utah with Cody, but mm-hmm. Bo is in studio with us today. Matt, our engineer, is not on mic. He's here. We've got Karen and Danny and Tim here too. It's great to have everybody in studio.
It's a little stressful. It's fun to be having an audience.
Thank you,
Karen. I know it is. But Cody, what's our topic today?
Today the topic is, who is your sleeper?
Right. Who is your sleeper? This is really fun to me, because what is a sleeper? What do we mean by that? The sleeper is that diamond in the rough, if you will. It's that person who other people didn't recognize as being talented and great in terms of contribution, and you find them, and essentially you awaken them, and you awaken the world to what they have to offer. And there is nothing quite like, in the world of work, finding people and helping them realize their latent potential. Mm. It's a gift to them around as we've gone through the holidays. This is a great gift to give. And as we move into the new year, it's one of those things like, who is God putting in my path that I'm going to waken up so they realize how valuable they are? And we were going to call this, what were we going to call it, Cody?
Who is your Hall of Famer?
Right. Because we're going to talk about
sleeper is kind of a sports term a little bit.
Yeah. Or Tracy, you were saying about like a movie.
It's a movie. Yeah, sure. A sleeper hit.
Nobody knew about it and you found it and you get to tell people about it. We love to find undiscovered goodness. And so we were going to talk about who's your Hall of Famer, because there's actually people in the Pro Football Hall of Fame that nobody thought would be any good. Mm-hmm. And suddenly they're considered some of the best ever. Mm-hmm. And so one of those who's not in the Hall of Fame because he's still playing, and I think he's 65 now, and his name is Tom Brady. I've been wanting to say this in a podcast for a while. If Tom Brady had been drafted by the wrong team that didn't understand what he was great at and put him in a position to succeed, he would not be the greatest of all time, the GOAT. He might never have been heard of.
Right.
That's not because he does it. He's not awesomely talented, but sometimes people don't know how to use that. And I honestly believe, he was drafted when, Bo?
199th, I think.
The 198 other players were drafted the year that Tom Brady was, in the sixth round. And it's not like people didn't know. They had 4 years of film on this guy from the University of Michigan. And team after team after team said, he's not going to be any good. Mm-hmm. And he turns out to be the greatest player of all time. Mm-hmm. Another great story. Who's another one, Cody?
Kurt Warner.
Yeah, they've made a movie about him.
Yeah, this movie's good. Is it out? I can't wait to see it. But
I think it's just come out. Is it called The Underdog or something like that?
It should be. If it's not, it should be called.
Right. So Kurt Warner, a Hall of Fame quarterback, MVP of a Super Bowl, almost won another one, amazing guy, was working at a grocery store. Nobody wanted this guy on their team. The St. Louis Rams at the time had three quarterbacks get hurt. They called him up out of the grocery store to be on the practice squad. More quarterbacks got hurt. They actually put him in a game. He was so good. They win the Super Bowl. He's one of the best quarterbacks of all time. Mm. Tell me then, if the NFL, who prides itself on game film and measurements and testing and all of these things, can miss two of the greatest players ever, who in our organizations is a sleeper, a future Hall of Famer? Right. That is just waiting for someone to discover that they have so much more to offer.
Mm. Yeah, and we were kind of dissecting, how does this happen? What are the factors that actually led from them going to a sleeper to being a Hall of Famer? And I think one of the things that, people are bad at evaluating talent, we'll talk about that
right.
one, but there's this other, I'm not sure people are looking in their organizations the way they need to find people like this, like really evaluating, because I think that maybe some of the lines that are drawn on a job description, there's so many barriers from taking someone with raw talent to become a Hall of Famer that we miss over and over and over again. And like you said, there's probably tons of people in our organizations that are drafted 199th that people don't see their full potential and they never get to realize it. There's probably a bunch of Tom Brady's that we never heard of. Maybe not a bunch of Tom Brady.
I actually believe there's people that would have been Hall of Fame quarterbacks and done amazing things in any position, in any sport, who just didn't get a break. So my friend was a field goal kicker in college. His name's Barry Belli. Now he runs a wine company up in the... Great guy. He was phenomenal. But the two teams he got brought into had Hall of Fame kickers. He barely got cut. And he just never made it and went on and did something else. But what's the difference between him being a Hall of Famer and not? It's just being in the right situation at the right time and having somebody say, hey, that guy's better than we think.
Yeah.
Maybe we should find another place for him. Mm-hmm. But so I'm absolutely convinced that the world is full of people that could have done amazing, amazing things and still could if somebody just took the time to look for them. Mm-hmm. And so what you said, Cody, I love, and that is that our job descriptions are too narrow.
They are. We're looking at too few characteristics about people, right? Like if you look at a quarterback, you might say arm strength and can they run? But also there's decision-making, team leadership, accuracy, physical health, availability. And what's that like in the workplace? Do we look at somebody's poise, intelligence, and experience? But we can also be looking at how do they connect and relate to other people? Like there's so many other layers to who people are that we can be looking to affirm, acknowledge, and speak life to people about the genius that they bring, about the sleeper that they might be, that they might not even see in themselves.
And the question I have is, are we walking around looking for that? Do we even have our antenna up for that? Or are we so focused on what we're trying to do? We have a sleeper in our office, and she knows this. She wouldn't be at all insulted by this. She's in the room with us right now. Yeah. And so her name is Danny, and we were looking for somebody to help us do some administrative things in our office. She worked at a hair salon close to our office, and I got my hair cut there. It was mostly for men, by the way. And while she was cutting my hair, I was talking to her. I do that. I'm an extrovert. And she was telling me about her life and the challenges she'd overcome and challenges she was dealing with there. And it was really impressive. I really liked hearing what... And so I was just like, wait a second. Maybe God had me meet this person for a reason. Mm-hmm. I came back and told one of my colleagues, hey, I met this woman who just cut my hair. Maybe we should hire her. And Jackie said, let's go back and meet her. So like the next two days later, we went in there and we're like, can we talk to her? And she was like, what are you doing here? Anyway, it's a long story. And we said, we finally interviewed her and hired her. Mm. She was a very unlikely person for us to hire. So right away, we were like, wow, we found a little diamond in the rough here. Mm-hmm. But it got much better than that, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because we put her in the wrong role. Because we said, well, if she's going to be an administrator, then she's going to have to be really organized and structured and all this other stuff. And she wasn't loving it. And then we figured out, you know, she might be better working with people like in customer service and answering their calls and working in a less structured environment. And she is a Hall of Famer. Mm-hmm. Nobody in our company can do what she does.
Right.
She's flexible. She doesn't get flustered. She answers people's questions. And it's watching her is like discovering an artist doing something that they were always meant to do.
Yep.
That wasn't going to happen if we weren't constantly asking ourselves, maybe she should be in a different job. Maybe we should hire her. And it was just a very cool thing. One of my favorite things about our company is watching Danny and realizing what she's done. That's not a compliment to us. It's only that we had antenna up and God put her in our lives and we said, let's follow up on this.
Right. And I think you described the two things that are really important there are one, you need people, and if you're a leader or manager, or you need someone like you, Pat, who walks around with antenna up for potential, you know, and it doesn't, and I think sometimes people, like, the context, it's not just potential, like, Kurt Warner was at a grocery store, not on a football team, and Danny was at a haircut store.
Or, right.
Like, is it a store?
A haircut store.
Come on.
If you don't have antenna up, there's potential all over the place. We tend to look down in the organization, who's the next man up, and then do they fit this role? And so that the first thing is people aren't looking. And the second thing is the rigidity of the role.
Right. Like,
if Danny probably would have been miserable and quit by now or not worked out if we left her in the role that we initially hired her for. And I think more companies, managers, and organizations need to understand that, like, hey, that's actually a disservice to have that level of parameters around.
Right.
We can't look at someone, look at what their talent and skills are, and then actually put them in a position to be successful.
Yeah, and let me just be really clear. This is not saying we're great people and I'm a great guy for doing that. There is a self-interested part of this. Finding sleepers is to your advantage. Mm-hmm. I love this story because she is doing a great job. I mean, it's always good. And I think as around the holidays now, it's great to think, who can I help? Mm-hmm. But she's actually helping us. Mm-hmm. And it was because we found her. It wasn't like if we'd gone to some hiring agency and found somebody with a rigid, they would not have been doing as good a job.
Right.
Tom Brady, they didn't do that as a favor to him. They found somebody who could turn their team into the winningest franchise ever. And so he served them, they served him. So I don't want this to sound like it's all altruism right. and self-congratulations. It's not that at all.
I don't think anybody on the podcast thinks you're a great guy. No, I'm just No, that's not the point.
Thanks. I feel better now.
The other dynamic I'm thinking about as I hear you say that is you don't just have to be the boss to do that.
No.
You shouldn't only expect the boss to be the one to look out for sleepers and diamonds in the rough. How do you all do that when you're not in the leadership seat?
Yeah. And it's not even in the workplace. If you're a school teacher, where's that kid who is like actually really bright, but they don't fit the stereotype of how people learn? Give them an opportunity to learn in a different way. And that kid's going to come back. Well, Cody, didn't you just tell us a story today tell us the sleeper from when you were in college in admissions. We almost forgot.
We didn't even, we talked about this earlier. So I was telling the story where I worked in college admissions. And what was interesting is, they had a policy at the university I worked at where if you're an admissions counselor, you have all the criteria for this person can be admitted based on GPA and their class load and credits that they transfer over. But once a year, every admissions counselor got to play basically like a trump card, like, hey, even though this person doesn't meet the criteria, I want to use my card on this person. And again, I don't like telling the story for the same reason. It's not about me, but
I'm making you tell it because it's such a great story.
There was a family friend of ours who I was friends with, the older sister, and her younger brother took a hard right turn after high school and made a lot of bad decisions and just like had a hard life but was ready for a second chance. Like literally
a hard bad turn, you mean?
A bad turn. Yeah.
Wasn't a political thing.
Right. No, but this literally, you know, made some bad decisions and really was ready for a second chance and didn't meet any of the criteria for GPA otherwise. Mm-hmm. And I talked to the parents and I wanted to make sure, and you actually asked me this, like, hey, there's a way that you don't want to play the trump card and then that person feel worse. Like, oh no, I can't do this. Wanted to make sure that they were really in the right position to succeed. And he got into this university. He did extremely well. It changed the entire trajectory of his life. Probably once a year, his mom or his sister will reach out to me and be like, I cannot believe that he got a second chance that way. And it really was just that he's a sleeper. I mean, every indicator in the world was, this is probably not going to work out. And then he had this underlying potential. Cool. Yeah, it was amazing.
So why, these stories are great. Why don't we do this more often? Are we scared?
I honestly think it's about not being intentional. I think that we just get so caught. It's kind of like we talk about managers. Why don't more managers stop and talk to their people about what's going on in their lives? Mm-hmm. And I think they just go, well, who am I to do that? It's not my job. And I'm so busy and they don't really care. I think that if we just slowed down and said, am I supposed to give this person a chance?
Mm-hmm.
And again, it's not giving them a chance if it's not going to be good for them. Mm-hmm. But if we just said, that's part of my job in life is to find people. Because everyone's done it to us. When I was in college, I took economics and I was in macroeconomics my freshman year and I was terrible and I was going to fail. And after like three classes, I could tell it was really mathematical. I didn't understand it. I went to my professor, Professor Teeples, God rest his soul. Professor Teeples said, Pat, you're really smart, but I think this quantitative stuff, you should go to this whole different track. There's this other professor across campus. Go talk to him. I took all that other professor's classes. I loved it. I did well. He found that I was a sleeper. He saw that I was being evaluated for the wrong thing and helped me do that. So, but if you're a professor and the person comes to you and just says, I'm not doing well in your class, they're like, well, buddy, good luck to you. It's not going to work. Bo, you had a story about a church where you were working that had this happen, right?
Yeah, I had a colleague and they were up for the next promotion. They were looking at the next promotion and the next job was going to require them to be in lots and lots of meetings. And this person hates being in lots and lots of meetings, but they thought the next thing in my career is to try to get promoted. And we just kind of sat around one day and helped him discover the thing that you're best on our staff at and probably best in our city at is connecting to people, making people feel like they're included, like they're informed, like they belong. We should just make you the chief connector. Your job should be more to be in the hallway and connecting with people and out in the community than it should be to be in the room. And that actually wasn't my insight. That was his peer's insight to say, this is what you bring to me. This is what I see that you're doing in my life that helped him. Imagine if instead he felt like he was a bad meeting goer because he feels like that's what you're supposed to do. Imagine if you were, I forget which economics is the right one and wrong one. But
that was qualitative, not quantitative.
Until somebody comes along and says, this is what you could do, you might end up chasing the wrong thing. And how many years of your life do you want to spend chasing the wrong thing? And sometimes it just takes somebody next to us affirming the thing that they see that we're able to do.
Yeah, let me make this super practical and super easy. As we begin this new year, just get in the habit of constantly seeing somebody who's good at something, genuinely, and going to them and saying, do you realize how good you are at this?
So good. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because if you did this kind of stuff, you're going to be a Hall of Famer. But everybody's a Hall of Famer if they're doing the right thing. Yep. Tom Brady was not a Hall of Famer for the Raiders, but he was going to be for the Patriots.
Well, and I think that that's the interesting part is that Tom Brady is not the greatest athlete of all time. It's not like he had all the raw talent and that was the thing. It was that Bill Belichick and the Patriots decided, you know what he's best at? And you said this, Bo, is like decision-making. He can read the defense. He knows what throw to make. He knows exactly what to do, and he's very disciplined at it. And so imagine like, the idea that if that box is so rigid for him, he could have gone to the Raiders and they didn't see what his potential in decision making, and he doesn't end up a Hall of Famer. Or and
he might be working at a grocery store.
Yeah,
and not married to a supermodel.
Not married to
probably not.
Yeah, he's got a better life as a result. No. But I think that we do that all the time in organizations where it's like, here's the box. Let's put a person in that box and. Hey, we'll do a decent job. And we talk about working genius as a way of understanding their gifts and stuff. But I think more organizations should get a little messier with what they think a job description is and how a person can contribute to the organization.
You know, something I just realized. Oh, Tracy, what were you going
to
say?
Oh, I was just back to your advice. I loved that advice. But as I reflect on it, I really think some leaders would find that uncomfortable saying what you just said.
Yeah, like, why is that?
I don't know. I mean, it's so crazy to me. But calling someone out on like, hey, you're really good at that and I want to be more like that. I think that makes some of us uncomfortable. It's easier to be in that box. Mm-hmm. It's easier to be rigid.
Wow.
Yeah, it's that's a little safer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Yeah, sometimes probably the organizations that find sleepers, whether they're a football team or a company, are the ones that are a little bit more comfortable stepping out of their comfort zone and being a little bit less restricted in the way
like
they think
Cody said, messy.
A little scrappier. Yeah.
You know, so we were talking about, I won't use the names, but we were talking about another quarterback on a team who got traded, even though he was pretty good. And the general manager traded him to a team where he would fail, even though he could have traded him to a team where he'd have been successful. And I guess the problem in the NFL, I'm going to give the general manager a little bit of the benefit of the doubt, although I think it's terrible. Is you have to play those teams, and so they'd rather not see somebody succeed go someplace else. Let's say the Raiders take Tom Brady and go, we wanted a guy that could run. He can't run. You know, he'd be great at the Patriots, and they're going to beat us in the playoffs every year for the next 10 years. So let's trade him there. But in the rest of life, it is not a zero-sum game. Find somebody who you can change their job. You could even move them into another organization, and they could be a Hall of Famer. And so I think if we just think outside the box that way, it would be a good thing. And what a gift it would be this year if we just kept finding people and turned them into Hall of Famers.
Isn't it interesting, Pat, how we all probably remember the person who kind of first said that to us, whether it was the microeconomics thing, but the person who first said, I think that you could do this. Isn't that an interesting idea that you could be that person for somebody this year?
Yeah, that's a greater gift than anything you could give somebody.
I was actually talking to Pat earlier, and I remember when we started this podcast, I was like, hey, who are you going to bring on to be on the podcast? And you said, I think you can do it. And at the time, I was like, I don't think so. And now I'm a mediocre podcast co-host. So I feel like that trajectory is pretty great.
You're fantastic to do this with. It's fun. All right. Hey, thanks for joining us today on At the Table. This has been a blast. It's great to have a studio audience and everybody in the room together. I hope you're having a great holiday season as it ends up, and we're wishing you a happy new year. God bless.